Afternoon, everybody. Hello. Welcome, everyone. Great to see so many people here filling up the room. That's fantastic. Thanks for coming. My name is Taylor Ricketts. I'm the director of the Gund Institute for Ecological Economics, and I'm a professor in the Rubenstein School. And it is my great pleasure, both as director and professor, but also personally, to welcome these two people to campus. Andrew Bomford, I'll start with him. He, I must say, is probably the ecologist currently working that I admire most anywhere. He is a professor of conservation science at Cambridge University in the UK. He's a fellow of the Royal Society, which is pretty much kind of the highest honor that a scientist can get in his country. But most importantly, his sort of combination of natural history, so knowing the natural world, and quantitative rigor and clarity of thought conceptually makes for a really influential and fantastic guy to read and know and follow. He asks really big questions in sort of disarmingly simple and elegant ways and comes up with insights that influence me and a lot of other people. So that's Andrew. So can you come on up, Andrew? Andrew's a Burak professor, or Burak lecturer here, so visiting under that guise. The other one is Steve Pulaski. Steve is a Marsh professor, so he's visiting UVM repeatedly each year. And he, like Andrew, is of all economists working now, is the one that influences and inspires me the most. So now you can see why this is such a great thing to have them both here at the same time. He's the Fesser Lambert Chair of Ecological/Environmental Economics at the University of Minnesota. He's got joint appointments in the ecology and environment, economics departments there. He's a member of the National Academy of Sciences, so just like Andrew, he's got sort of the highest honor his country affords a scientist. And he, to me, is inspiring mostly for seeing very complex issues in a very simple way at their core, what actually they hinge on. He can see through that complexity to what's at the middle of it better than anybody I know. It makes him a joy to collaborate with. He's also wonderfully uninterested in disciplinary boundaries. He just wants to solve problems no matter what you call it. And that's also very inspiring to me. So honestly, no pair of people inspire me personally more than these two, and we have them here together, which is why this is so exciting. So Steve, come on up. So we figured they both have invitations to be here on campus. Why not bring them here for the same week and pull off something like this, some sort of joint appearance? And I think it kind of illustrates the kinds of work and thinking and interdisciplinary problem solving that the Gund Institute is built to do, right? To bring ecology together with economics, natural and social sciences together, aimed at real world problems. So I think for that reason, this event is a great one for the Gund Institute to host. I think it's also revealing the diversity of people who helped us nominate and get these people to campus. I'm just gonna thank them, but also illustrate to you the diversity of interest that they attract here. So Tom Vogelman from the Ag School, Sarah Solnick from Economics, Jean Harvey Barino from Nutrition and Food Sciences, Naomi Fukugawa from the College of Medicine, Allison Brody from Biology, Josh Farley from Community Development and Applied Economics, Ernesto Mendez from Plant and Soil Sciences, Matt Sayer from Continuing Education, Jillian Galford and Mike McDonald from the Rubenstein School of Environment and Natural Resources, Beverly Wemple from Geography. So all of those people from that diversity of places on campus all really were interested in bringing both of these guys here. So thanks to them for helping us do that. Okay, finally, a quick word on the format here. I kind of feel the need to explain and justify this title about an economist and an ecologist walking into a bar. You might have noticed we're not actually in a bar, and I hope that didn't disappoint people. It's a metaphor, okay? But the idea is to actually have a bit of an unusual format as well for these sorts of events, and to have more of a conversation than just a traditional seminar. So we're going to have some initial remarks from each of them, and then a conversation about sort of the big issues in sustainability. And to that end, we've got what I think is sort of the ideal person to help guide that conversation, and that's Jane Lindholm from Vermont Public Radio to kind of moderate. Anybody in Vermont knows her from Vermont Edition and other previous gigs at NPR, like Radio Expeditions and Talk of the Nation and Marketplace, and now she's here hosting this daily radio show for Vermont Public Radio. So I also learned that she's a nature writer and photographer as well, so this is kind of in her wheelhouse too. So I will stop there and bring Jane up, and she can take over from there. So welcome, Jane. Just one more thing, a round of thanks to these three people that are sitting up here. Also to RETN, who's our media partner and is taping this for broadcast here in Vermont. And of course to all of you for coming. So thanks, over to you, Jane.
Thank you, Taylor. I'm really thrilled to be here, and I'm not going to do any further introductions because Professor Ricketts did it beautifully, except to say, in introducing myself and my role here, I grew up in a family of academics, and I'm sorry to say this in the halls of academia, but sometimes you need a non-academic who can say, I'm sorry, what do you mean by that, and how do we actually make that happen? So that is how I see my role today, and as Taylor said, we'll have some opening remarks, and then we'll have more of a pub-style conversation where you say, yeah, sit down, let's talk. You know, after you've had your speech at the pub, now let's talk. So let's get to it. First, we're going to have Andrew Bomford.
Thanks to Taylor and Brendan, our colleagues here at the Gund Institute, and all those other people for enabling me to come to Vermont for this week. I'm having a really lovely time, and I'm learning a lot. And thank you very much for inviting me into your bar. I'm a conservation scientist. That means I spend my time working on how best to safeguard the future of wild species and wild places and maintain the benefits that they provide for all of us. And I'm interested, together with several of my colleagues you can see here, in particular in this question of how we're going to manage in future to feed our own species while at the same time leaving some space on the planet for the other 5 or 10 million species that live here. So I want to say just a bit to open this, some controversial thoughts perhaps about what we've found when we've been trying to answer the question of how to feed the planet without eating it. First, why is there a problem? Well, we know that while food production has been increasing over the past 50 years, it's more than managed to keep pace with human population growth, and that's a really marvelous and very important thing. We know that it's also done so at enormous cost to the non-human environment. So just some numbers, farming now covers over half of all agriculturally usable land. It's more than doubled nitrogen fixation rates through water abstraction for irrigation. It's caused almost half of recent sea level rise on the planet. And as this figure shows for the world's birds, but you could construct it for other creatures, it's by far the biggest source of threat to biological diversity, especially in developing countries. That's where we are already, but our population is set to rise to 9 or 10 billion over the next half century to century. And we know that on a per capita basis, people consistently demand more calories in their diet and, crucially, more protein as they get wealthier. Based on that, it's clear that demand for food is going to rise enormously over the next half century. Even if we're going to be able to do a great deal about food waste, which we absolutely must, even if we can do something about the rise of meat eating as people get wealthier, even if we can do those things, it seems certain that global food demand is going to rise dramatically. So how can we meet that demand at least cost to other species? Well, broadly speaking, a couple of divergent solutions have been put forward. There are others, but two extremes I'm going to talk about, focus on today. The approach most commonly advocated by the conservation community, the community I belong to, can be labeled land sharing. And it stems in large part from the realization from Rachel Carson and many others since that industrial farming lowers biodiversity on farms. As an antidote to that, land sharing argues for retaining on-farm habitat features, things like hedgerows and small ponds, and reducing the input of chemicals. And it's an approach that's received widespread political support in the European Union, for example, but it also typically lowers yields, by which I mean production per unit area. And we know it does because, on average, because otherwise we wouldn't have to pay farmers to adopt it. The fact we have to pay them to do it tells us that it's lowering their yields. And that recognition of a trade-off between farm yield and on-farm biodiversity has in turn prompted the very different idea of land sparing. If sharing lowers yields, then to produce the same amount of food, we need more land under farming, leaving less land for natural, unfarmed habitats. So perhaps instead we should increase yields on existing farmland, but combine that with sparing or even restoring intact habitat elsewhere. So just to run over that idea, in these cartoon landscapes where the black cells are intact habitat and then the grey through white cells show land being farmed at increasingly high yield, the left-hand landscape is a land-sharing landscape. It's got wildlife-friendly but low-yield farming. And then over on the far right, there's a land-sparing landscape where farm yields are very much higher and farmland itself is correspondingly less wildlife-friendly. But for the same total amount of production from the landscape, we can have more area under intact habitat. And of course, we can imagine intermediate scenarios too. What might be best for biodiversity depends, it turns out, on how the population density of each species, each creature in the area, responds to increasing yield. So how each species' population density changes as we move from left to right, from zero yielding intact habitat through low yield farmland, eventually to the highest yield farming that we can get in our region. For few species, these responses, things we call density yield curves, they will have positive slopes. That means they're winner species. These are species that benefit from farming. They're going to do well as we want to farm more. So as conservationists, we don't really need to worry too much about the winner species in the landscape. Loser species, on the other hand, will have negative sloping density yield curves. And which approach to farming is least bad for them, they're all bad, but which one is least bad for them depends on the exact shape of those responses, the shape of those curves. Loser species which have this kind of shape curve in the dark blue, they're relatively insensitive to low yield farming. And that means they do least badly under a land sharing world. On the other hand, we can think of loser species with this shape curve in dark red. They depend so much on intact habitat that they do least badly under land sparing, because only land sparing can safeguard enough of that intact habitat that they absolutely rely upon. And then you can imagine species with more complex density yield curves like this one in purple, which may do least badly under intermediate yields, under some intermediate solution. What matters then is the overall frequency of these different curve types among all the species we're concerned with. So what we need to do is move on from some theory to collecting some data. I'll show you a bit of data. Here's our group's results for Ghanaian birds. So birds living in a forested landscape, what was originally a forested landscape in southern Ghana. Exactly which approach to farming is best for a given species depends on how much food we want to produce from a region. So here, what I'm doing in this chart is plotting out the frequency of those species preferences, shown by the same colors that I used before, as production increases in our region from left to right across that chart. And if you focus on current day production levels, so that left-hand vertical line, you can see that some species in paler colors, those are the winners. They're going to do better from farming than in its absence. But the majority of species are in dark colors. Those are the losers. And most of those loser species in dark red have got those density yield responses that mean that they would do least badly under a land-sparing world. There are a few there in dark blue and purple that would do least badly under land sharing or under intermediate yield farming. But those tend to switch to preferring land sparing. The dark blue and the dark purple become red as we move from left to right across the chart. So as demand for food production increases, which it doubtless will into the future in this part of Ghana. So those are the results for Ghanaian birds. In fact, they're for wide-ranging Ghanaian bird species, ones which have large global distributions. But this result, this predominance of red in that chart, is much more striking for Ghanaian bird species with narrow global ranges. These are the ones that are only found in this part of the world. They're the species that, as conservationists, we tend to be most concerned about, and where decisions in Ghana are going to have the greatest effect on the persistence of these species into the future. Importantly, we've repeated this work for many different parts of the world, many different sorts of creatures. So we've done it for trees, for grasses, for sedges, for daisy relatives, plants in the family Asteraceae, for butterflies, and for dung beetles. And as well as doing it in Ghana, we've done this work in India, in Uganda, in the Pampas, in Kazakhstan, and most recently in Mexico and in Poland. And remarkably, we get very similar results in every region and for each group that we've looked at, with most species being losers from farming and most losers preferring land sparing over land sharing or any intermediate approach, with that pattern becoming more pronounced as demand increases and if we focus on species of particular conservation concern. So what can we say from that? Well, first, importantly, we've just looked at food production. We've not looked at the vitally important job of reducing demand through cutting waste or addressing diets. We've not looked at wider issues around food security. But for the food production part of the puzzle, we can say for those places and groups that we've looked at, most species are losers, most of which would do least badly under high-yield farming, provided that is indeed linked to sparing remaining habitats for nature. There's still lots we want to do. We want to extend the geographic and taxonomic reach of our density yield analyses. We want to test some less simplistic models, and we need to look at other outcomes of land use, such as greenhouse gas emissions. Although we've done some work on carbon fluxes, which again points in the direction of land sparing being the least bad way forward to limit emissions associated with farming. Most importantly, we don't have all of the tools we need to implement land sparing. We need, as a conservation community, I think, to work with agricultural scientists and others to identify and encourage techniques that can increase yields at low environmental cost. So land sparing in this world certainly isn't about intensive farming business as usual. It's about finding smart ways to boost yields sustainably. And we need to look for practical ways of explicitly coupling high yield growth with land sparing. If left to market forces alone, we know that high yields won't safeguard natural habitats. We need explicit policy and market mechanisms to do that. We might get a chance perhaps to talk about that, the policy side of things later on, but from the biological point of view, my conclusion is that land sparing is probably the least bad approach to reconciling farming and food production in theory. And for me, the question is now becoming, how can we deliver it in practice? Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Professor Barnfield. This was really interesting, and I'm interested now in thinking about how can we, perhaps starting from a different perspective, get maybe within spitting distance of the same ideas or some sort of comprehensive strategy. And for that, Steve Pulaski.
Okay, thanks very much. Thank you all for being here. Taylor, I've learned something. I don't think it's the word economics in the title that got everybody here, or probably ecology. But actually, if you designed a really good experiment, so bar is definitely an option here, but saving the world is other, and I don't know which of these two pulled you all in, but maybe it's the combination. But in some sense, it's the combination is good because in dealing with these kinds of problems, it's not purely economics, it's not purely ecology. We actually do need to blend lots of approaches for thinking about what I'll call the challenge of sustainable development. And I'm gonna pitch this as sort of two interlocking or independent challenges. And Andrew did a really nice job of setting up some of the issues that I'm gonna talk about. He talked about producing food, but also trying to safeguard biodiversity. And how do we do both? We only have one landscape. How do we think about those trade-offs? So I'm gonna pitch this in terms of sustainability. So sustainable development can be thought about as sustainability and also as economic development. But we're doing things now to this planet that have consequences both for biodiversity and also potentially for future human well-being, our own species' well-being. And so we need to be thinking about what we're doing and how can we safeguard both for biodiversity and for future generations of humans. But at the same time, we also do need development. There are many people on this planet who don't have much. So, you know, 800 million people approximately are malnourished. So thinking back to the food issue that Andrew talked about. So how do we think about raising standards of living, but do this in a way which is consistent with sustainability? So the problem oftentimes, so I go back and forth between the world of economics and ecology. And when I'm with my economist friends, oftentimes they're thinking about strictly economic development. How do we, you know, how do we raise people out of poverty? The problem with just thinking about that is that if we just focus on that and don't think about the natural capital or nature's part of this, we risk being unsustainable. When I'm over in conservation science or ecology, if we don't bring in the human component, basically we risk being irrelevant. So how do we actually satisfy both of these or bring these both together? I'm gonna start from the following. So many of you may be aware of something called the Millennium Ecosystem Assessment. It's now been out for about 10 years. What I liked about this was it tried to bring these together in a way. So humans are dependent upon nature, right? So ecosystems and biodiversity are essential for human well-being. One of the charts that came out of the Millennium Ecosystem Assessment is the following. I don't care that you can read line by line, but hopefully you can see that there's lots of triangles pointing downward. So each line here is an important ecosystem service. In other words, an important thing of benefits that nature provides to people. And most of those arrows, disturbingly, were headed downward. In other words, the trend through time was negative. Okay, we're depleting natural capital. We're reducing the benefits, the life support system for human well-being. There are a few that go up, but most of them go down. Okay, why? Well, I'm gonna put on my economics hat for a moment, and if we think about how much of the economic system is organized through markets and market behavior, markets are a very powerful set of incentives. They provide signals of value for some goods and services, but clearly not for all. They clearly don't provide a signal of value for things which are of great value, right? So the economics terms are called externalities and public goods, but just think about anything that nature provides you, clean air, clean water. Those don't go through markets. Markets don't provide a signal of their worth, and there aren't people taking actions to produce clean water like there are to produce commodities for which they get paid. So we're systematically ignoring the contributions of nature, and we systematically undervalue these ecosystem services. If I go back to that chart that I showed you, I just circled the ones that go up, okay? All the other ones are flat or going down. And I'll read off the ones that are going up because there's a pattern here. So this is crops, livestock, aquaculture, and then carbon sequestration. The first three, crops, livestock, aquaculture, these are all commodities. People produce these, right? Farmers, ranchers. Actually, I don't know what you call aquaculturists, but anyway, the people who produce aquaculture. So you know, these are people, they're getting paid for their output. So it's not perhaps a surprise that those ecosystem services are doing well, but the vast bulk of the other ecosystem services that nobody gets paid for are declining. Okay, so we have a problem. And if we're going to make the challenge of sustainable development in the 21st century, we really have to change this. So I'm going to give you just one simple example of how to think through this issue. And then a last slide to think maybe about, just to tease you with other examples. But the point here is we need to move fast on this. So there are some the good news is there are some examples of how to do this, how to move economic systems or political systems. The bad news is, are we doing this fast enough? Okay, so I'm going to give you an example from the Willamette Basin in Oregon, where I used to live. And this just shows you kind of a map of the region and kind of the basic biogeography of the region. So you've got the valley floor in the middle, and you've got the Coast Range, a little sliver of it on one edge, and the Cascade Mountains on the other edge. And the other map just shows the landscape pattern or the land cover. Okay, so forests up in the hills and the mountains, and agriculture primarily in the middle. And what we did was we actually benefited by working with groups in the valley, in the basin, who had put together sort of future scenarios of land use. And they actually had maps for three different scenarios: one more business-oriented, one kind of business as usual, and one more conservation-oriented. And they had these maps from 1990 up to 2050. They were gracious enough to let us have the maps. And then what we did was we said, well, what are the consequences of these future land use plans in the basin? And we were interested in evaluating this on a number of ecosystem services or direct, what are the direct returns to landowners? So you can see there's six things that we tracked, including how much phosphorus was going into the Willamette River, and how much erosion was there, and what was the flooding, how much carbon was sequestered, how were various species doing in the basin, and finally, how much return was there to landowners, either through agricultural crops or timber production or housing developments, okay? And the three dots or the three lines here are showing you under these different scenarios, the more conservation-oriented scenario, business as usual, more development-oriented scenario, what happens to these various things that we care about from the landscape. Now, that's one way of looking at it. Another way of looking at it is to kind of try to summarize it into trade-offs. And Andrew talked about trade-offs. You know, we want to produce food, but we also want to have biodiversity. How are we going to do this? So here are three options of how we can have land use in the Willamette Basin. And it gives us trade-offs among these various different things that I showed you on the last slide. The circles on the left are kind of the classic way of looking at this. So if we think about on the horizontal axis is the returns to landowners, so the economic value or market value. And the vertical axis is how well is biodiversity doing. And you can see our three scenarios. So the green one, the conservation scenario, does well for biodiversity, but doesn't do as well for the market returns to landowners, right? And the other two do much better in terms of market returns, but less in biodiversity. So classic trade-off here, right? So looks like, you know, you can't, it's one or the other. If you look at the triangles on the right, now the only thing that we did differently here was we said, what if we could actually value one of the ecosystem services? Not all of them, but just carbon. So what if we could pay landowners, for example, for sequestering carbon, recognizing the value that they're contributing to larger society? When you do that, now you get the triangles on the right. It's no longer a classic trade-off, right? You get better. You know, the green triangle is better both in terms of biodiversity as well as the returns to society. And this represents a fairly basic point to me. Is like, if you don't have your metrics right, you know, if people are responding to the wrong set of signals, they're going to make decisions which may be bad both for nature and for people, right? So we need to get this We need to get this right. Now, there are a number of ways that you can do this, and we might talk about some of them. Hopefully you'll ask us about some of these. You know, this can be a policy mechanism, changes in the rules. Here it was a simple change in the rules, like what if we could establish a carbon market, either through a carbon price or a cap and trade system or something like that. But there are other ways that one could do this as well. But I want to give you some examples of where things actually are moving now in really trying to address this problem. So one place I've been fortunate enough to work over the last few years is in China. And somewhat surprisingly, especially if you think about the air pollution that you see in Beijing and other Chinese cities, they've actually had a very aggressive program of payments for ecosystem services. The largest conservation program in the world, the Sloping Lands Conservation Program. They're now thinking about doing something that they call gross ecosystem product. So we all know that GDP, or gross domestic product, is kind of a basic economic measure. Well, can we produce something which captures this notion of how is nature doing? How are the ecosystem services or natural capital doing? And make leaders of provinces responsible not just for GDP, but also GEP, right? So changing the set of metrics, changing what society rewards. In Latin America, there's been an example of paying landowners upstream to do things which produce clean water downstream. So downstream water users paying upstream landowners to preserve clean water. It's called water funds, and it's spread to more than 40 watersheds, cities in Latin America. And even in the U.S., we actually are doing quite a few things. So Office of Management and Budget, just earlier this month, released guidance on ecosystem services to the other parts of the agencies in the federal government to say, here's guidance for how you need to incorporate ecosystem services and natural capital into your planning and your policy. And there are examples also of existing programs, Conservation Reserve Program, Wetlands Reserve Program, and others. There's examples in the private sector, which I won't go into now, but there are a number of places now where we actually are moving to try to do this. But as I say, I think the race is on. We're doing, if you still looked at, if we updated that Millennium Ecosystem Assessment and looked at how the trend in ecosystem services is, I don't think we would have changed it too much. I think most of the trends that we saw as of 10 years ago are continuing. So how can we ramp this up and speed this up and actually get those things turned around and conserve nature, both for nature's sake as well as our own? Thanks very much.
Thank you both. That was fascinating and really thought-provoking. And you both mentioned that one of the things you really want to get into here is regulation and how do we do this and how do we make people move in these directions. Andrew, you mentioned that there are certain ways that are good right now, that we know the right type of farming to do, for example, to give the biggest bang for our buck in terms of wildlife. And Steve, you just said all of these great examples of where we're doing this right. So what's the rub? If we know the right way to do it, and there are examples of people who have the right idea, what's not moving fast enough? Why aren't we going there?
Esther? I guess, A lot of these ideas are quite novel, and they run counter to the way we've done things for a long time. And at the moment, quite a lot of interests in land use, for instance, benefit from the way that we are doing things at the moment. So the way subsidies are structured at the moment incentivize people in a very different direction. And that means there's a whole load of people and organizations and institutions that are doing quite well out of the system, even though society as a whole or biodiversity might not. And so there's a lot of resistance to that sort of change. So you see that, in my own country in Europe, where farming policy is run out of Brussels, and there are very strong lobbies that push it in a particular direction, which favour the people that favours the people that fund those lobbies, but which isn't
I would argue, the best outcome we could have, even for ourselves, even without thinking about anything else. So there's a real uphill struggle trying to reverse that. And part of that is then imagining what those interventions that could switch things around would be, and then beginning to talk to people, beginning the conversation that people say, well, actually, you know, did you know you're paying this much to do the wrong thing? How about we just begin to have a conversation about how it would, what it would take to switch direction. And part of that is not only about identifying those alternative better potential outcomes, but also I think not only knowing that it might be better to go down that route overall, but being explicit about who the winners and the losers in that will be, because those will then be the people that will perhaps benefit most from a switch and also the ones who are going to oppose it most. You can identify that, and that's a very important part of that. So breaking down those sorts of diagrams that Steve was showing that, you know, society would be better off perhaps if we can get into that win-win. Actually, that may be true, but within that there will be some losers and some winners, and we need to know, break it down to know who those will be before we can begin to identify the constituents that are that are going to be at the nub of that discussion.
But it seems like from what you're talking about that at least in some ways the farming community are winners in this. You're asking the farming community to have a higher yield on this amount of land rather than share the land. So why isn't the farming lobby going along with you on this?
So we're also, that's one part of it. We're saying that from what we've found, high yield farming is part of the solution, but it's only part of the solution if it's coupled with land sparing. And that means taking land out of production in places that are already largely converted, like the UK, for instance, or parts of the US. So that means that some farmers in that system would have high yielding land, other people might take their entire farms out of production. So how do you come up with interventions that are equitable across that piece? You know, how do you invent a system that means that those people who give up farming cows but are actually farming carbon or nature instead, how do they get a reward for that? And how do you link those two outcomes together? And that gets to be more complicated, well, obviously very complicated.
Yeah, no, I was going to say, I mean, so part of this is perception. I know in Minnesota, so we're in the Midwest, and there is a, oftentimes it's almost, well, it's like Washington, D.C., it gets to be sort of ritualized conflict. You're from the environmental community, you must not know farming, or what you're saying must be antagonistic to farming interests, and likewise, you know, the farming, it's like, well, you want to do that? Oh, the environmental community. So part of this is just perception, and there's where science really helps. You can come in, you can work through the facts, and if you can have a rational discussion, break down some of these stereotypes and say, there are cases here where, in fact, doing well for the environment is not doing worse for farming communities and vice versa. So there are some win-wins or whatever. But there are real trade-offs, and even when there are win-wins over for society, just as Andrew said, there are cases where there's going to be a particular party that's hurt. Like, I'm going to say your farm is really important for biodiversity or water quality, so you have to know who the winners and losers are, how they're winning and losing, and we have to have enough flexibility in the political system and in our institutions to basically make people whole. So we say, all right, overall we're doing well as a society by making this change. Let's take some of that gain from elsewhere. Let's make sure that you're being made whole, that you're not sacrificing for the good of the community, and devise this. I mean, we do this in other arenas. If we, you know, want to build a roadway and we take somebody's property, we compensate. So there are mechanisms for doing this. You know, we haven't been so flexible or creative yet in the environmental space, but hopefully we will.
So is it a marketing problem? Because, I mean, there are areas where that works, and yes, not everybody, certainly in Vermont, we know that there's some unhappiness with eminent domain at this very moment.
Yes.
But I can't see a politician winning on a strategy of saying, I'm going to preserve grassland habitat by taking some of this private land out of commission and getting elected. So is the environmental movement not very good at marketing? Because we're talking about short-term gain versus long-term gain and sustainability.
So we actually do, interestingly enough, have a program in this country where it's not eminent domain, but the Conservation Reserve Program actually pays farmers to take land out of production and put it into grasslands or other perennial vegetation for precisely these regions. Now, I think you know, you're right to focus on the fact that eminent domain is not very popular, which is why most of these programs are voluntary. You take that off, and now you actually are saying, well, if people are volunteering to do this, it must, you know, it's we're not forcing them to do it. So there are ways of doing this. My one criticism of things like the Conservation Reserve Program is you really want to not just take all comers, and they try to do this, they try to target, but you really want to think carefully about where are the important areas for water quality or biodiversity. And this is where it's hard politically, because now I'm going to say, well, I'm going to pay a lot for your land because it's environmentally valuable, but I'm not going to pay a lot for your land. But
is that
biologically, you really want to do that, yes.
And do we need to do that?
I think we do. There's some statistics about, you know, really focusing, like if you're on water quality, there are some crucial parts of the landscapes deeply sloped or close to rivers. You absolutely want to target those. Land that's further away or flatter, much less important for that. So if water quality is an interest, you definitely want to target.
And that's
Andrew,
the case of biodiversity too. I mean, there are places where it's going to be much more valuable to try and spare land than in others, where there's higher biodiversity value anyway, where the opportunity cost in terms of lost agricultural production might be lower. That's not an excuse for sort of saying, right, we're going to farm lowland England, in my case, and not farm Scotland. It's not at that scale, but at some intermediate scale between that and the size of a farm, there are places where it makes sense to concentrate your conservation investments. And that's politically unpopular. So at the moment, agricultural subsidies in Europe as a whole, in the UK in particular, have gone on the basis of let's spread them everywhere. And in the environmental strand of those subsidies, that means everybody wants to get a payment for the environment. Well, actually, they're not doing much for the environment. And they're not going to be able to do very much for the environment. These other people could do much more. That's politically unpopular, but would deliver much more. So there are some hard and difficult things that you are going to need some politicians to or leaders to be able to bite the bullet and promote.
I was going to ask you, how do you get people to overlook their short-term interests in the face of what is in the long term necessary and even more in their best interest and in our best interest if we'd like to have a population that can sustain itself? But it sounds like what you're both saying is money. We need to focus environmental efforts and dollars at the most important and most strategic targets. So is it all about the money?
I don't think it's all about the money. I think people are actually much more concerned about these things in other ways too. In fact, one of the things we're doing this week is thinking about all the other things that influence decision making besides the money, and how you can promote some of those. But it certainly does help with a lot of decision makers, and it brings a lot of people to the table who might not otherwise be interested. You don't always necessarily turn it into money. It can be in terms of palpable material self-interest. One of my favorite examples comes from a fog forest in extreme western Ecuador, incredibly important place for biodiversity, west of the Andes. For a long time, conservationists had tried the traditional conservation method of going to poor villages and saying, your land is incredibly important for nature, on behalf of the planet, you know, do the right thing and don't cut down the forests. And for decades that failed. Some smart biologist actually was then sitting there for a while thinking, hang on a minute, what do the people get out of this forest? Is there any reason they might want to keep it? Notice that this intercepts fog coming off the ocean during the dry season, keeps their fields wet downstream. Then went and worked with the villagers to measure that fog interception in places where they'd left the forest, places that they hadn't, found there was a huge impact on people's ability to farm. The next door village that had cut down its forest couldn't farm in the dry season anymore. People saw that. And within 3 months, after decades of conservationists trying their usual arguments, the people decided to set aside the forest. No money changed hands, but it was an argument that was expressed in terms of a material gain to the village.
I was going to say, I don't think it's actually about the money at all. It's really about what kind of society we want to live in, and what kinds of benefits are we actually getting. And you know, so Andrew just gave a really nice example of, you know, if we maintained the cloud forests, we get these kinds of benefits. it's really nice when the benefits accrue back to the people who are making the decision. It's a little bit tougher when you've got the upstream, downstream issue. And, you know, there, I think actually that's where the money comes in, because you have to basically say you've got a mismatch between those, in a sense, who are bearing costs and those who are getting the benefits. But ultimately, it really is about the benefits that you're getting. You're trying to get clean water, and the value of that clean water far exceeds whatever destructive land use was going on upstream.
When you talk about what kind of culture we want to have and trying to get people to think really deeply about that, I think that is something that Vermonters pay a lot of attention to. And we have created policies, governmental policies, community policies, that are geared towards preserving the landscape and having small-scale communities thinking a lot about sustainable agriculture. But based on what you're both saying, that's not necessarily going to save Vermont from some of the problems that the world is facing. When we think about the fact that most Vermonters value not living inside tight-knit towns and cities, we like to live out in the country, we like to have land. That's not good when we talk about having land that is preserved without any, you know, breaks in it, any kind of habitation. Our biggest greenhouse gas emissions come from our transportation sector, and that's part of having a very rural state and a rural economy. And if we want to get to a better place in terms of emissions, we're going to have to deal with that in the way we've structured our communities. So Vermont is in this interesting place in terms of trying to think very hard about these issues and care about them profoundly, but also how do we then change or adjust what to us is the most important value, our landscape and our natural working landscape, into something that's actually sustainable?
Yep, I think that's a real
well
challenge. I agree. And you see the same in communities like that in the UK, where you have people who very much want to do the right thing. And sometimes, if you stand back and take a hard-nosed view at it, what appeals, or what is perhaps a popular way of trying to do that, that may not actually be quite as good as some alternatives that may seem at first, less palatable. So one would be, as you say, going and living out in the country. Another would be, what size gardens do you want? You can play the land sparing sharing game with urban planning. It's exactly the same. Should you have clustered housing, or should you have bigger towns, bigger footprints, but everyone's got birds in their garden? And it turns out when you do the numbers, you get the same answers. Biodiversity would prefer us to live in high-rise flats and have very good parks, very good, national parks, kind of, or nature reserves, whatever, coming right onto our doorstep. And there's a similar one around organic food production in a way, in that, that may reduce the on-farm chemical use, perhaps, but if the footprint is, if the yields are lower, then the overall footprint may be greater. So there's a difficult trade-off there that's unsettling, I think, for people trying to do the right thing necessarily to think about.
So one thing that I completely agree. I mean, there are these trade-offs. I mean, we all kind of want to live in an idyllic, isolated place without a lot of neighbors, maybe. But if we all try to do that, of course, it's self-defeating. So, but I think the thing that I'd like to mention is where you started. Vermont as a community is actually thinking about these issues and trying. So I talked about markets, and markets certainly have a role, but political and community action and thinking as a town or thinking as a state together about, well, what trade-offs do we want to make? What kind of society do we have? And the reason why I mention this, as I said, I've been going to China, and it's a really interesting contrast. Within a week's time period, I was in Washington, D.C., and I was in China. And, Washington, D.C., as we all know right now, is just dysfunctional. We are not making decisions. The kind of talk that we would be having here, it's just not happening, at least when it's going through Congress and the administration. So, but in China, for better or worse, whatever you think about the ruling Communist Party, if science comes in, and in fact I've seen this, if science comes in and says, here are the consequences, and this is, from your understanding of what the Chinese people want, if you say you could do this, but it's going to cause you these kinds of damages, that actually gets listened to. And there's a filter in the U.S. right now, which is, you're either free market or you're against free market. It's like, we actually have a rich set of institutions, and some of our issues fit very nicely in having markets do things, and others like this, like how do we organize landscape? That is not something that markets are good at doing without some type of political or community discussion about what we want it to look like.
We are seeing globally, though, a push for more people to move to cities. That is where the migratory patterns are happening. People are moving into cities. So we will, in theory, then, have a landscape that we can decide what we want to do with. But then you also have this disconnect between people who are living in those high rises and don't have a connection to nature and to the landscape, or you don't have the people who are doing that farming, so you have these huge, large-scale industrial farms. So how do you then advocate for people to move into population-dense regions and have those patterns, but also have this connection that, that we feel so strongly about in Vermont and that helps us understand our landscape and care for it?
I think that's a really important point. It's something that's been worrying me for a very long time. We did a project about 10 years ago in the UK where we asked school kids. I got interested because my kids were that age and they were running around with field guides. And then one stage they had a friend over and they had a field guide to Pokemon. I didn't realize there was such a thing, but you can get it looks like a Peterson field guide, but it has Pokemon creatures in it. And you could cover up one bit of it and they would tell you all the characters, just like my children would say, you know, they'd say, oh, you know, that's
Pikachu.
Exactly. So they could identify things from the characters or from it. It was fantastic. So we did a little experiment where we showed school kids images of four or five out of 100 species that they, like a bluebell or a tree or a deer, or an oak tree or a red deer or something like that, that they might reasonably expect to be able to put a name to, and the same for Pokemon. And we found that before they got to school, they knew a little bit more about their own natural history. They knew, this was where we live, is relatively quiet part of the world, so they didn't know much about Pokemon at that stage. By the time they got to about 7, they knew about the same about Pokemon and about natural history, and after that they got less and less interested in natural history and they got more and more interested in Pokemon. So that disconnect is real and it worries me. And we want to try and do those kind of trade-offs with nature connection as one of the benefits that we're at risk of losing if we... but it's not clear to me exactly how that would work out. So it may well be the case that having a more black and white world like that would result in reduced nature connection, but it might not. There was more black on that left, right-hand landscape, the sparry landscape, than there was on the left-hand landscape. So actually, you may not have nature quite as close, but when you do get into nature, it may be much more like nature and less like gardens. So I'm not quite sure how that trade-off works, but it does worry me about the kind of models we're coming up with that we haven't yet dealt with that.
I mean, in my own life, this is on a very small scale and not at all what you're talking about, but I have this constant problem wanting to pick up wildlife. I want to touch it. I want to pick up the salamander. I want to catch the bird. I want to catch the snake, which I realize is stressing the animals and not good for them, but it gives me this great understanding of how they move and how they feel and what they look like and what their tongues do that I wouldn't have if I didn't touch them. So you do have that. If you don't have people interacting with nature or with their food and understanding where their food comes from, it's hard to feel a connection to, you know, caring about what our agriculture looks like and the people who are producing it. So this is also going to be heresy in Vermont, but are GMOs the answer?
I would say they're part of the answer. So our view, we are completely agnostic about how you get high yields, provided two things. One is that they have lower externalities per unit of production, and the second is that there's some way then of linking them to sparing land. There are lots of other issues around any of the technologies that you might think of, and GM presents quite a few, but we're interested potentially in thinking about rice fish co-culture being going on for 4,000 years in parts of China and Japan, right through to GMOs, via integrated pest management in the middle. And we're looking at across the piece. I think it's very important to be agnostic and to evaluate these things on the evidence. And I see something which worries me a little bit with the mood towards GM in Europe over the past 10 or 15 years, which is some of the people we work with on this stuff are agricultural technologists who are working to come up with GM or all sorts of non-GM techniques. but that take chemicals out of the equation. Their vision is a landscape where you don't have to put in pesticides, except in extreme circumstances, where plants are much better at scavenging, so you can put on much scavenging minerals, so you put on much less fertilizer and so on. When they come up with trials for their products, not only does it cost them a lot more to than with other techniques to get them to the stage of having a plant that does this, then the field trials cost them hundreds of thousands of pounds per trial to protect the trial. Have a double fence barrier, wire fence barrier around the whole thing. Have guards patrolling day and night to stop the crop being destroyed. And what that does is it forces GM. This is a state organisation. It can hardly afford to do any GM. The only people that can are increasingly very big agribusiness who are never going to do that for cassava and for crops that I care about in tropical communities, because it's no money. So if we can't, if we rule it out through that kind of activity in my country, I think poorer people lose out and the environment might lose out.
Steve, do you take a perspective on that?
Yeah, I mean, like Andrew, I'm very pragmatic about this. I mean, this has been, I know, a really emotional issue for many people, and it's hard in the following sense. It's like, you know, if you're doing something which is new, it's hard necessarily to know what all the ramifications are and so forth. But we do a lot of things in agriculture right now which we know are very destructive. I mean, you come out to my part of the country in the Midwest, I mean, it's, you know, wall-to-wall corn and soybeans, and the water quality, basically in southern Minnesota, you know, all of the water basically is on the impaired list. You know, we do not have species other than the ones that are your winners, the small subset of the native fauna that actually can tolerate this. So it's incredibly intensive agriculture. So if there are ways to do this in a way which is safe and which is reducing the destructive actions of current industrial agricultural processes, and I'd say let's pursue this avenue. So I'm not an expert in this, but I would say let's be pragmatic and compare, you know, not the perfect or whatever to, because we don't have the perfect now. We have industrial agriculture which has many negative environmental consequences. And the point is how do we get out of that, produce the food, but not the negative consequences.
In terms of producing the food, do we fundamentally, though, need to control our population? And in doing that, do we need to have regulations? Do we need to have countries that are saying we are actually going to make it more difficult for you to have more children?
Interesting question. I think population is a big, huge issue here. You know, we're talking about going from 7 to 9 to 10 billion in 50 years. And even though population growth is decelerating and we're probably not going to double global population size again, and that's a marvelous thing for our grandchildren, I think. Nevertheless, the population is growing very fast. And I think it's for individual countries and people to decide, but there are plenty of...
You don't think there needs to be some sort of...
Well, I don't think you're going to get a UN decision, you know, ratified on population. I can't imagine that happening. It'd be even more difficult than getting agreement on climate change, I suspect.
Yeah.
China did do that, and according to some interesting evidence from the Pew, for instance, who go in and look at Chinese attitudes to things, a lot of Chinese people are quite happy that they did that, that that was done. And having said all of that, if you look at the numbers, in terms of total consumption, not just food, but in terms of total consumption, that's the product of the number of people and per capita consumption. Over that interval where we're going from 6 to 9 billion, that's 0.5, 50% increase in number of people, per capita wealth, pretty closely related to consumption, is going to go up by between 3 and 4-fold. So if we want to think what's really driving the multiple at the end, it's both of those things. But unless we get a handle on this incessant feeling of entitlement that we can have more and more at each successive generation, then that's the really big one, not population. I mean, they're both important.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but just to pick up on that, so We're at $7 billion now. In, say, 2050, we'd be $9 billion. I mean, so there's an increase there. But it's not like the exponential growth that we saw, let's say, between 1950 and 2000. We basically went from 3 to 6 billion. Okay, so population growth is a concern. It puts more pressure on resources. So, you know, to the extent that we can limit that, that gives us space. But as Andrew said, you know, if you look at where the pressure is going to come from going forward, it's actually rising incomes. And what happens with rising incomes is that people want to eat meat. And if you think about what's really putting pressure on cropland and what we need to do, it's not population per se, it's the switch to meat consumption. You know, so it's like 8-to-1 conversion, you know, calories in animals. So, you know, we got to grow 8 times, you know. So it's a huge issue. And in fact, looking forward, if you think about the increase in required calories, whatever, most of that is actually not population driven. It's diet driven, or like in my part of the world, we made this decision to, or in the US, we made a decision to say, hey, why don't we produce ethanol? So most of the corn that's grown in Minnesota does not go to feed people. It goes to feed cows and cars. So, you know, that if we're really worried about that kind of pressure, that's something that we would change.
So the conspiracy theorists were right. It's your types that were behind that news this week that bacon causes cancer.
We've been rumbled.
You know, we're here at a university. We're here where there are so many young people who think about these issues, and for all the good work that the two of you are doing, you and your generation are not the ones who are going to ultimately have to push this forward as we move to 2030, 40, 50, and beyond. So what is the message that you're trying to give out to young people who are already thinking in these realms and trying to figure out, first of all, what do we do? And second of all, thanks a lot for giving us this situation.
Yeah. No, I think, I mean, frankly, when I teach my classes or come to universities, I'd say, you know, put the pressure on the corporations and the business people and, frankly, academics like us. Like, what are you doing to leave us with a world like you found it, or at least as well off? I mean, so that's this whole issue about sustainability. Are we leaving to the next generation at least as good a situation as we found? And as you said, I think in many dimensions, our generation has failed the next generation. So, you know, I think it comes back to your first question about, you know, how do we move this? So some of this is science, you know, just getting the facts and showing the consequence. Like, you know, the problem is it's meat consumption, say, or whatever it is. So that's part of it. But the other parts of it are being politically in tune and active. You know, organizing your own lifestyle so that you're doing this more sustainably. But so there's a many different dimensions: scientific, political, personal lifestyle. Do them all, why not?
But as you just mentioned, when you go to Washington and you work there, you see a total logjam. So, yeah. You know, that's demoralizing for many people, but particularly for people who are perhaps thinking about what's my career gonna be and where am I gonna be able to make a difference?
No, that's very true. I mean, I sometimes suffer. It's very good to go back to Minnesota or come to Vermont. As I think if you spent too much time in DC, you would be sort of permanently demoralized. I don't have an answer on that. I guess my answer is always there usually are multiple ways of getting to an end. Right now, I would not advocate spending a whole lot of time trying to lobby Congress. It's just that's not going to move things. You know, showing what can be done in a small state like Vermont or in your town. Oftentimes, there's real power in a specific example of people showing a different way. And I'll give you an example of that. So the water funds that I mentioned, that started from New York City. But really where it spread in Latin America is in Quito, Ecuador. They said, hey, New York City did this. Why don't we try this here in Quito? It was very successful there. The Nature Conservancy helped kind of to spread this idea, but basically, you know, the idea was very clear to people, like, oh, if we want to protect our water, we ought to be doing things upstream. And it makes sense to people. And Keto showed how you actually can do it. So, you know, I would say if you're blocked at one level, go another route and find a place where you actually can make a difference. And oftentimes, even if you're just doing it in one small town in Vermont, if you provide kind of the right key, the right insight, that can spread.
Andrew? I'd agree with that. I mean, I spent a while a few years back trying to write, feeling exactly like as you were suggesting, feeling pretty despondent, and then realizing that's part of the problem in itself. And that conservation, you know, if we give people just some hopeless choice between despair and denial, which is what, you know, you could accuse conservation and the environmental movement of doing at times, then you're not going to get anywhere. And you have to offer people ideas that the notion, the state of mind that means that things can progress. And if you, I mean, for that exercise, I spent a while visiting a whole load of places where things are moving forward, and they are. And you can celebrate those. You can celebrate them both to learn from them and try and, but also just as a general sort of message that this isn't inevitable. We have a choice. We've lost. I mean, I would, depending on how you do the sums, we've lost about half of nature over the last since the Industrial Revolution. So there's the nature's glass half full or half empty? Well, it's up to you to decide, but if you decide it's half empty, then I guess all bets are off. If you think it's half full and you start thinking of ways that it can be, that you can slow its draining, then you can begin to move forward. And the interesting thing, I think, both from the research angle and also kind of from the real world, real politic angle, is that if you look at what I think are the interesting examples where things are being turned around and where you can gain something, it's from thinking in lateral ways. So we've gone at this problem for a long time, this is a conventional biological science. We'll find out species are going down the pan, you need to do this, we'll tell politicians and they'll do it. And the world doesn't work like that, and it may not have worked ever like it, certainly doesn't work like it now. And what you need to do is, you know, on the research side, it's about a whole load of different disciplines coming together. The answers are really about human behavior, not about animal behavior, for instance. So it's about a lot about natural and social scientists working with one another, along with all sorts of other disciplines. And on the applied side, this is not about the conventional agents of conservation solving the problem. It's about them working with all sorts of other sectors of society, mainstreaming the problem and finding novel allies, new ways forward, often ones based on the kind of results that Steve was talking about, which deliver wins in unexpected ways for people who weren't part of that discussion. And then you find new ways forward because you have new allies, new friends.
And fundamentally, you do have hope? When you go to bed at night and pull the covers up, you're not demoralized?
I'll wait till after Paris, but apart from the Paris, no, in general I do, yes, of course.
I'd love to open the conversation up here for those of you who have burning questions and want to make sure we have some time for that. We have a microphone set up right here. Please go right to it. We are recording, so to make sure that we have all of your questions recorded, just step right up to the microphone and you can form a line. We've got several minutes for questions.
Hi there. Can you guys hear me?
Not yet.
Okay. Well,
yes.
Great. So my name is Heather Furman. I'm with the Nature Conservancy here in Vermont. And thank you all. This conversation has been really great, Steve, Andrew, and Jane. I'm really intrigued by the water funds conversation that you brought up and hoping you can draw on that experience to answer some of my questions. We're in the process of developing a natural infrastructure blueprint here in Vermont for the Champlain Valley that really focuses on addressing water quality by protecting the highest priority areas in our floodplains and in our river systems for protecting water quality and community resiliency and habitat. And so that's a scheme where you're directing funds to those highest priority areas. And I'm wondering, we also have a clean water fund that's been established here in Vermont during the last legislative session. So I'm wondering, based on your experience with water funds in Latin America, are there some market-based incentives that we can be thinking about and applying to that water fund to help us really incentivize and catalyze the protection of our natural infrastructure?
Great. Sometimes it's not really necessarily straight out market, but it's trade, right? In this case, it's like downstream water users are basically bargaining or trading with upstream landowners to provide clean water downstream, and they can do that in a way that's cheaper than the downstream users can clean up the dirty water. So sometimes it's just figuring out how to trade, right? How do you put the beneficiaries together with those people taking the action? There are other cases where, in a way, there are market mechanisms, but there needs to be a policy pump at the beginning. So people talk about cap and trade. For those of you who don't know what cap and trade is, so let's say we want to limit the total amount of sediment coming out of a river system. So we establish a cap by government regulation. But we basically say, we don't really care who it is that cleans up within this basin, but we just have to have a cap at the end. So we'll distribute permits to farmers or landowners so that they can have this, and then they can trade amongst themselves. And if somebody can take an action and reduce sediment, which is great. So economists love the trade part, but you got to have the cap first, or nobody's actually going to pay for this stuff. So it's a combination. It's not pure market. It's a combination of regulatory action and market activity.
Yeah, come on up. I should also mention, as a radio person, these mics drive me crazy, but you have to be very, very close. So bring out your inner, Bieber, probably not Bieber, bring out your inner Beyonce, and get as close to the mic as you can.
So I'm a student here at UVM of both policy and agriculture, so sorry if this is a little pessimistic. But so as you said, land sparing is this highly theoretical and still something that needs to be very specified. But even though developing nations make a great testing ground for agroecological processes like that, how can we account for the time and effort that's going to take when there's building pressures of famine and poverty and climate change?
Good question. So I guess we look at we're not looking at taking land out of production in the meantime, and as a result reducing production while tinkering goes on. A good example of this sort of thinking happening in practice is happening now in some quite large areas of the Brazilian Amazon. Some of you will probably know this part of the world better than I do, but we're working with Brazilian colleagues. One of the main drivers of the first big wave of Amazon deforestation was clearance for cattle production. And if you go across that region, as an outsider, you'll notice there are very, very few cows in those cattle in those cattle producing areas. Production is yields are way lower than they might be, and so with colleagues down there are working on a program to work out how to enable and incentivize farmers to boost cattle farming cattle yields, so that they can then accommodate the next big wave of agricultural expansion going on there, which is soy expansion. They can accommodate soy expansion without having to take any more forest out of production. So you get your incentive as a farmer if you don't take any, you get help with your yields if you don't take more trees out of the system. So overall production is going up, farmer incomes are going up, and the footprint of farming is staying the same. So those are that's an example where the experiment, and it is being run on an experimental basis, isn't reducing production. In fact, it's increasing production. It's just trying to work out, can we do this in as least painful a way as possible.
So if I can just build on that, many places in developing countries have what people call yield gaps. In other words, if you look at kind of the climate and the soil, and you compared it to some other place in the world maybe that's more developed, the yields in some places are far higher than they are in many developing countries. So that's actually an opportunity, just as you said. Gotcha. You can actually, by improving access to markets or improving access to fertilizer, you can greatly increase the yield. Now that's both good and bad in the following sense. It's good because it gives higher income to farmers. It's good, it produces more food, perhaps where there's more pressure to do so. So that's all good. There's never a pure win, however, because now it's like, oh, well, now it's more profitable to farm here. So you might be putting more pressure on locally if you actually solve this yield gap problem. So you need to think carefully about you know, how can you increase the income of farmers and the yields and the food production, but do this in a way which is also going to maintain, you know, protected areas, biodiversity, water quality, because you're going to be increasing nitrogen fertilizers and so forth. So, you know, it should be done mindful of these trade-offs. Oftentimes, it is not. Yeah.
Is there always going to be a trade-off, though? Can you do all of those things at once and replicate that around the country or around the world?
You know, in one sense, you can be smart about things. Like if I said, well, I here's my goal in terms of food production, and could I produce food, or even more food, and do this in a less harmful environmental way? Absolutely. I mean, you know, we can shift where crops are grown, how they're grown. There's a lot of leeway. I mean, you know, one way being so bad at things right now is there's lots of room for improvement. The question is, how do you actually get, you know, how do you structure it so that, you know, you get the information to the farmers, that they have an incentive to do this? And that's where I think it's, even right now, it's not a question so much of the science as a question of sort of getting incentives and institutions and knowledge into the right hands.
I'm going to build right on that point and ask, does high efficiency necessarily mean very large scale? I have a friend who's an organic farmer in Vermont who claims he gets the same yield per acre as chemical farming. He admits to getting a much, much, much lower yield per farmer hour, but he says, I pay for labor and a chemical farm pays for petroleum, and we end up with about the same cost of inputs. I'm just paying it to farmers and he's paying it to truckers. And on a similar point about housing, does high efficiency housing necessarily mean New York City, or could it mean the center of Richmond? Could it mean living in small, beautiful towns, but not living on 10-acre lots?
Yeah. So I can answer the first of those. I've never been to Richmond, so I can't.
Richmond is a town of about 5,000 in Vermont that I use just as an example, because a lot of people here will know it.
Yeah, and it's representative of most of the towns in Vermont, which are, you know, a couple to several thousand.
So on the first of those points, no, it certainly doesn't mean large scale. So I can't underline enough that what we're talking about when we're thinking about a land-sparing solution isn't about intensive farming business as usual. It's about high-yield farming and the least bad way to get to that. And there are many examples which involve small-scale farming. To give you one of my favorites, it comes from around the Great Lakes region in East Africa, particularly around Lake Victoria, where some of those people in the Agricultural Research Institute I mentioned a while ago, which has pioneered a lot of the early insecticides and is seen by some as a place where bad things are invented, those people are working very hard on trying to take pesticides out of the system. They've done some very clever work on what's limiting yields in maize in that part of the world, main crop, where the main limit is something called a stem borer moth, which comes in, lays its eggs inside the stems of the maize, the larvae hatch out, the stem becomes weakened, it falls over, the crop rots. They've looked using their very clever chemistry at how the moths, find the maize. They cue in on chemicals the maize gives off. They then looked at a whole load of other plants in the same place that farmers were familiar with, and used the moths to assay how exciting the different plants were. And they found maize was quite sexy. They quite liked maize. There were certain plants which they found really attractive, and some they found really horrid. Turns out some of the ones they found really horrid are leguminous. They fix nitrogen. So they've got the farmers to put that in amongst the maize crop. The moths find it repellent. They leave the fields. Meanwhile, the maize gets fertilized by the legumes. And as they leave the field, the farmers have then planted a trap crop of these super sexy grasses around the outside that the moths can't resist. They lay their eggs in them. Because these grasses have co-evolved with the moths over millennia, they also know how to cope with their eggs. So when the larvae hatch out, they cover them in gloop and the moths die. So this system is called push-pull farming. You push them out of the fields into the hedgerows. It boosts farm yields. It's done on a farm-by-farm basis. It's still small-scale agriculture. And because yields are much higher, farmer labor needs are higher, rural employment's going up. So people that were drifting off to very disconnected lives in cities are coming back, staying on the farm. And so social
capital is improving at the same time. That's using small-scale farmers to boost yields.
In terms of, I'm not going to be able to answer it as authoritatively on the city side, but you know, the real point here is how much land per person are you taking up? You can live densely in a small community. It's just that there are, you know, only 5,000 people as opposed to, you know, 5 or 20 million people in that community. I think the real question is, you know, how do you organize it? How much land is that community taking up relative to the population?
But beyond that as well, there have to be certain social structures that are in place. There have to be jobs. If you want somebody to both live in their small community and work there, so they're not just living there and commuting to Burlington, then there has to be either a job market there or some sort of telecommuting possibility. Right. And what does it take to get to that position?
Well, you said part of it, which is, you know, we actually now, you know, there is much less reason for many jobs to be in particular places than there used to be. The telecommuting is a good idea. I mean, I don't necessarily need to be every second in Minnesota, for example. You know, Taylor and I work together and we do that electronically. So there are ways to basically change the job location equation so that you don't have to be fixed in one place. How do you do that as a policy? I don't know, I haven't thought about that, but yeah.
I think we've probably got time for two more questions.
Hi, I live in Vermont, and so I'm very much in favor of local options. But we do seem to have some problems that are bigger than that, specifically global warming. Yep. And that, for that, we want a solution, quote unquote, that is fast enough, and you mentioned speed. We also want it to be big enough, which you haven't talked much about. So here's my question. I heard a passing reference to the Paris conference. What do you hope will happen there? And specifically, do you expect any solution that doesn't involve a price on carbon?
On the first of those, I'm hoping for an agreement. I guess, which would be a major step forward, and an agreement that has the vast majority of nations signing up to it. So I welcome the fact, hopefully, that Canada will be back on board. I'm not holding hopes for Australia, but China and India, an agreement in the first place would be something. But I completely share your concerns that this needs to be bigger scale and faster than anything that politicians currently seem prepared to sign up for. But at least having people not walking away and being back on an upward trajectory in terms of what's going on in conference of the party meetings would be a step in the right direction.
So if I can comment really quickly, Bob, you're right. This is a global problem. It's not going to be solved by little local actions. We need large scale actions. We need, frankly, I mean, that's why people are pinning their hopes on Paris, even though, you know, how many years has it been where these UN conferences come back with nothing? I think you asked what do we hope for. Yes, I hope for an agreement. I hope that they actually establish a cap on carbon such that we could limit to 2 degrees. What am I realistically expecting? I'm actually expecting them to take some steps forward. In fact, they already have. So you have China saying we are going to take actions which will start to reduce our carbon emissions. You have India for the first time saying we are going to take actions. So you've got the major players now that are doing a majority of the emissions in the world currently. So, you know, the US, China, India, European Union, India, they all are now on board saying we are going to step up and take some actions. Now, whether that's fast enough or serious enough, I don't know, but at least that's a much more hopeful place than we were 2 years ago, where we were stuck in this sort of north-south, you know, you've got to move first, and the U.S. saying, well, we're not going to do something unless you do. So, you know, I'm actually, again, I don't know if it's fast enough, and I don't know if they're going to go far enough, but it's a much more hopeful place than I was 2 years ago.
All right, let's see if we can squeeze the last two questions in. Good. No, this
Hello. Can you hear me? I wanted to go back to the point about your advice to the people in the room and what they can do. I think that we're all very privileged and lucky and fortunate to be listening to this talk, but what would your advice be if we bring in inequality to this question? So the people that can't be fortunate to be listening to these topics, what can they do if they can't, if they aren't necessarily considered part of the system, how can they affect the system?
Yeah, it's a really important question, because we haven't really talked about equity. And sometimes when I'm talking, I'll say that, you know, the two biggest problems in the world not only are it's really sustainable development. The two sides of that are, how do you solve inequality? How do you bring people up? And there's an economic dimension to that, but as you say, there's a political dimension to that too. I mean, people can be having enough to eat, but they don't necessarily have a voice in the system. Part of this is, we really do need to take the development part of sustainable development seriously. I mean, we do need to raise people up out of poverty. I mean, I take that as a, you know, that's as important to me, solving that if we don't solve the environmental problems, then nobody's going to live well. So, you know, maybe that does take precedence, but that other part of this is really important. I don't have a good, I'm not a political scientist, and I don't have a good answer for how do we bring in the disempowered into the political system. Clearly it's important. There are steps that people push, you know, the really opening up and democratizing things and, letting people have more say. But that's a hard one, and especially in some countries where, you've got very centralized power that doesn't want to let go. And I don't have a good answer for that one.
Lisa.
Do you?
No, go for it, Lisa. We'll have time for you.
Just I have a
always.
Short question on land sparing. Over the world, especially in the developing world, but in the United States too, whenever the government puts land aside to keep it for conservation, there's a lot of pressure from surrounding farmers to find some way to use that land, to take the trees, to grow the corn, or to run their cattle. Without paying the government for it. Have we worked out what it's going to cost to protect the land that is spared rather than leave it in private hands?
Yeah. Yes, people have got some handles on that. In fact, in a previous life, I used to play with a different bunch of economists who helped me with some of those things, trying to think about what those costs are. And they're very substantial, and they're as a conservation community, we tend to focus on the obvious upfront costs, so the management costs. What does it cost to patrol the protected area or manage the trees in a particular way or whatever it is? And those are easy to measure and they're small, relatively speaking. We still don't spend anywhere near the amounts that we need, but they're small. What are much more substantial are the opportunity costs that you're talking about, what people forego as a result of that area no longer being available for straightforward development. And those costs are much, much greater. They're very convenient to overlook because, if you have government by diktat, you can kind of ignore them for a while and hope they go away. Of course, they don't, but you try to. And so I think the conservation communities tended to ignore those at their peril. However, when you do look at those costs and you start to factor them in and think about how you would pay them, perhaps through compensation schemes, perhaps through all sorts of alternative ways of trying to meet people's foregone opportunities of conservation, even though they are much larger than the kind of numbers that conservation communities, the conservation world thinks about, or that we currently spend on conservation, they're still tiny compared with the costs of the benefits that we would lose if we lose those places in terms of ecosystem services. Not everywhere in the world, but in many, many places, the benefits, if we were to account for them properly, outweigh those real costs. So the trick is, I think, then thinking of the sorts of things that Steve was talking about, going back to the previous question about Paris, about putting prices on some of those values and then working out equitable ways of distributing the benefits back to the people who pay the price for foregone conventional development.
We've reached the end of our time here for this portion of our conversation, but I want to let you all know that there is a reception just out the hallway, and so we're going to carry on this conversation, all of us together. But before we let you go, let me first of all thank Taylor Ricketts and Brendan Fisher, who are co-hosting these lectures today. Thank you very much for putting this on. Brendan, I think, is in the back somewhere.
And also, please join me in thanking our very distinguished guest today. Andrew Balmford is a Burak Distinguished Lecturer for the academic year, and Stephen Pulaski is a UVM James Marsh Professor at Large. Thank you both very much for your insights.
Thank you. Thank you.